Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Hello everyone, it's my pleasure to introduce Mayur Naik today from Stanford. He's working with Alex Aiken on many things, including statically finding data races in Java programs. And today he'll be talking about his work. And he is already very familiar to us. He did two internships here and he's a Microsoft fellow. Mayur.
Thanks, Madan. I'll begin with a brief motivation for this talk. So here's a graph showing the clock speeds and the number of transistors in Intel CPUs that have been introduced in the past 3 decades. And one can make 2 observations from this graph. The first is it's easy to see that clock speeds have peaked in about 2003. So this is what was the projected exponential growth, but this is what actually happened. And another observation one can make is that the number of transistors continues to grow exponentially, at least for now. And what these two trends indicate is that vendors, not just Intel, but even others, have begun shipping so-called multi-core processors. These are essentially processors with multiple CPUs packed on the same chip. Now, what does this mean for software? It means that until now, what was happening was that clock speeds were increasing exponentially year after year. And what this meant was that even sequential programs ran faster every year. But in the future, as more and more cores are added to the same chip, primarily concurrent programs will be able to run faster. And what this means is that more and more software is going to become concurrent in order to gain the performance benefits of these increasing number of CPU cores. Now, it's well known that reasoning about concurrent programs is hard. To give you a concrete example, let's consider this sequential program, which essentially increments a variable x using a temporary t1. Now, this program has a single execution, but let's add a little bit of concurrency to it. And the least we can do, perhaps, is just make another thread. So now there are 2 threads here, both of which increment variable x. But the first one uses a thread local temporary t1, and the second one uses a thread local temporary t2, whereas x is a thread shared variable. So one thing to note in this talk is that I'm focusing on a particular concurrency model, and that is shared memory. So X is a location which is shared by both threads. There are other models such as message passing, about which I'm not going to talk in this talk. So let's see what happens the moment we add another thread to this program. So clearly, this execution can be extended as follows, where the blue thread runs to completion before the red thread. Then there's a symmetric execution where the red thread runs first. But then there are others, such as this one, where the blue thread is preempted by the red thread after the first statement, which runs to completion, and then the blue thread resumes. And you can see that there are 20 such executions. So in summary, by just adding one more thread, we have increased the number of executions from 1 to 20. Now let's see what is going on in all these executions. So let's suppose that x begins with the value k in this execution. It's easy to see that it gives the correct value k plus 2. And likewise for the second execution. But over here, it's easy to see by following this trace that x actually gets k plus 1 at the end of this execution, which is wrong. And this problem is well known as the lost update problem in concurrency. In fact, this and similar other problems are so fundamental in concurrency that they have a name of their own, which is called race conditions. Formally, a race condition is defined as a condition in which the same memory location may be accessed by different threads simultaneously. And furthermore, at least one of those accesses is a write. Okay. Now, race conditions are particularly insidious, even by concurrency standards. And the reason is that they are triggered in a non-deterministic fashion. And what I mean by that is that races typically occur only under very specific thread schedules. And thread schedules are inherently non-deterministic because they are determined by factors which are external to the program, such as the hardware or the operating system or the virtual machine. Furthermore, races do not have fail-stop behavior even in safe languages like Java. For example, buffer overruns are a solved problem in Java because you have fail-stop behavior. The moment an array, there's an array out of bounds exception, the moment you index an array outside the bounds. But there's no such case for race conditions. Also, races are fundamental in both concurrency theory and practice. races lie at the heart of many concurrency problems. For example, many researchers have shown that atomicity checking can be reduced to race detection. Likewise, we have found that static deadlock detection to be done in a precise fashion does need a good static race detector. And there are many other examples where race freedom is presumed while solving another concurrency problem. But races also have practical value. And here's a quote from a recent book on Java concurrency, which says that most Java programs today are so rife with concurrency bugs that they work only by accident. And this problem is going to get even more severe in the coming years as multi-core CPUs become more and more ubiquitous. And the reason is that not only are more and more programs going to become concurrent, but even existing concurrent programs are going to be stress tested, and more thread schedules are going to be exercised, which are going to expose these race conditions. So they are going to crash more often in the future. So let's return back to our example to see where's the race in this program. So I'll recall the definition of a race over here, which I showed earlier. And it's easy to see that by this definition, there's clearly one race between this pair of accesses, because they both refer to the same location X, and it is happening from different threads, and it can happen simultaneously because there's no ordering enforced. And both accesses are writes, so that is fine. But there's another race in this program, because there's a write here and there's a read there, and likewise, there's a symmetric race over here. Now, what can we do to prevent races? So the most common idiom used in Java for synchronization is the so-called lock-based synchronization idiom. And I'll denote it using this lexically scoped sync construct, which abbreviates Java's synchronized construct. This construct specifies both an expression on which a lock is to be held and the duration for which the lock is to be held. Now, locks have the mutual exclusion property, which means that at most one thread can hold a given lock at any time. And so what we are going to do is we are going to modify our definition of races to focus on the lock-based synchronization idiom. So now a race occurs if the same location may be accessed by different threads without holding a common lock, and at least one access is a write. Now you can see that because we are holding the same lock L in both threads, it's clear that none of these three qualify for a race, because in each of these cases, a common lock is held while accessing them. So all these races go away the moment we use the correct synchronization. But not only that, now you also notice that all these 18 executions, many of which had errors, also go away, because now there is an ordering constraint enforced between how these statements can be interleaved. Okay. So now we have these programs which use locks to guard certain data structures, and we want to know if those programs are race-free. So what has been done about this problem? Work on race detection began with the late 1980s. And then there was even more work in the 90s. And there was even, and there's even more work in the 2000s. And it's hard to do justice to all this work here. But one observation I would like to make is that the tools and techniques that have been proposed in many of these papers have found relatively few bugs. Even though there's plenty of evidence that concurrent programs today are riddled with races. And here's a more concrete comparison of the number of bugs found by other tools and techniques versus the ones that we found in an implementation of our technique, which we call CORD. So here's the sum over all over the numerous published papers on race detection, both static and dynamic, in the last 10 years for both C and Java. And that amounts to less than 100 distinct bugs. Whereas using CORD, we found about 400 distinct bugs. There's 392 to be precise. And these were in mature Java programs comprising about 1.5 million lines of code. And these bugs were deemed important by developers. Many of them, as I'll show later, were fixed within a week of reporting. Now, one thing to note here is that bugs are different from races, as I defined earlier. So multiple races might point to the same bug. For example, the earlier example had just one bug, which is the lost update, but there were three distinct races. So in terms of races, the number of races we found were well over 1,500. So, but multiple races will indicate the same bug, and that is why the number of distinct bugs collapses to 400. So typically, you'll have a lot more races by our definition than the number of bugs. And a bug is informally defined here. It is roughly like a fix in the source code. Yeah.
So there were a little bit less than 100 race bugs or concurrency bugs?
Concurrency bugs, yeah. So many of these papers just report races. They don't report bugs, and they just stop after reporting races. So in that case, we just took the number of races people found. So, but hardly, I think the largest number of races, largest number of bugs reported in any paper in the last 10 years has been by Engler and Ashcraft for three operating systems.
So this is for a different bench?
Yeah, so clearly, here there's a caveat that this is not the same code base. We definitely have all the, so the main problem here is, even though we are not comparing on the same code base, we do, one thing I would like to mention is we do include all the small Java programs that people have looked at in the past. But one reason I'm comparing them, even though they have different code bases, is that it just shows how useful a tool is when you can find a lot more bugs. Because when you have, for instance, a static analysis tool, maybe that it just has too many false positives, and that is why you don't report too many bugs. So it's not something that is to be taken very literally, but I think it does give a sense of how useful a technique or tool that has been published is in practice. Okay, yeah.
Are these real bugs, as in false?
No, no, no. So these are real bugs. So I don't say anything about false positive rates at this problem. These were bugs which were reported to developers, and probably some of them were fixed. Okay. So here's a static race detection approach. We begin with the set of all pairs of potentially racing accesses in a program, in a given Java program. And essentially, there are three cases to consider for Java. First is you have to consider every pair of statements which refers to the same instance field of a class, and at least one is a right. Or the pair of statements refers to the same static field of a class. Or finally, both refer to array elements. That is, they index certain arrays. These are just the three cases. But because it's quadratic in the size of the program, even a small 1,000-line program might have millions of such pairs to begin with. And our goal is to come down to the small subset of racing pairs, that is the pairs that are actually involved in races. Now, what are the challenges in coming down from here to the small set? To highlight the challenges, I'll recall the definition of a race once again. And one thing you can note immediately here is that any static analysis for race detection will have to approximate multiple aspects of the problem. In particular, it has to check whether a given pair is referring to the same location. Furthermore, is the pair of accesses happening from different threads, and is it happening simultaneously? Okay, can those two accesses happen in parallel? And this is mainly a precision problem. That is, you want to do a good job on each of these sub-problems so that you end up with as few false positives as possible. And what we showed in a PLDI paper last year was that a precise May alias analysis is key to solving this problem. And I won't define this term right now, I'll explain it later, but for now it suffices to say that this is a relatively large body of work in program analysis, and the key challenge here was choosing the right kind of May alias analysis and getting it to scale. And using that, we achieved a low false positive rate of 20%, which means that every 4 out of 5 pairs of accesses that we report to the user will turn out to be real races in practice. Okay. Now, another problem is what is the last part in the definition? That is, you need to correlate locks with locations they guard. And programmers typically have a mental model where they use certain locks to guard certain data structures. And we need to infer that correlation. And this can be viewed primarily as a soundness problem. That is, we want to prove that certain pairs of accesses are guarded by a common lock. And for this problem, we devised what is called a conditional must-not alias analysis. This is a technique we invented, and it was published in Popple this year. And the key idea here is that it circumvents the need for a so-called must-alias analysis. Again, I'll define this term later, but for now, it suffices to say that this is a relatively less known field than May alias analysis, because it's a much harder problem than May alias analysis. And nobody figured out how to do this well. And what we showed here is that you don't need must alias analysis for race detection. You can use what we invented, it's called as conditional must not alias analysis. That will be the main topic of this talk. Okay. So let's come back to the high level overview of our approach. Now, what we want to do is use a different static analysis to approximate each of these conditions. So we start off with the first condition, which is we want to determine whether a pair of accesses here even accesses the same location or not. And for that, we call that subset of pairs of accesses which may refer to the same location as aliasing pairs. Okay. But then we proceed to see, is the pair of accesses, is each pair of accesses in aliasing pairs happening from different threads? And of course, there'll clearly be some which are not. And we call the subset, which may be happening from different threads, as shared pairs. And then we go on to approximate the third condition. Can this pair of accesses happen simultaneously? Now, here we are not even reasoning about locks, OK? Here, simultaneously just means, could these two things happen in parallel? Now, this is a challenging problem because Java does not have structured thread spawning constructs. So just looking at the source code syntactically, you can't tell what things may happen in parallel, OK? So you have to do an analysis there to figure this out. And finally, and we call that subset parallel pairs. And finally, we are down to the final condition, is whether each pair of accesses here is guarded by some common lock. And we call that subset unlocked pairs. Now, we report all pairs which are retained in unlocked pairs to the user for manual inspection. And in practice, it turns out that the false positive rate, as I just mentioned, is 20%, which means every 4 out of 5 pairs in unlocked pairs that the user inspects will lie in this subset, which is racing pairs. We are sound, which means that we report all pairs of accesses that are racing. And of course, we are not complete because there are false positives over here. So since this talk is mostly about, this technique is mostly about alias analysis for race detection, let's see how one could use alias analysis over here. So here's a fragment of a concurrent program which has 2 threads which are executing these fragments of code. And each of these threads holds a lock on an expression and then proceeds to dereference a field F by following another expression. One thing to note is that L1, L2, E1, and E2 might be quite complex expressions, and they might hold values that are stored in data structures and passed around functions. So we can prove that field F is race-free if we prove the following. E1 and E2 never refer to the same value in any execution. And this predicate is typically called must-not alias in the program analysis literature. And in turn, it is computed typically by using the complement of the may alias predicate, which in turn is computed by what I call a may alias analysis. So may alias E1, E2 holds if E1 and E2 may refer to the same value in some execution. Okay. Now let's see what is the work that has been done in may alias analysis in the past. So clearly there's a large body of work in this area, as some of you might be familiar. And perhaps one of the main ideas in this area is what is called context insensitive analysis that I'll illustrate using this example program. So we have 2 functions, foo and bar here, both of which reference field F through some expression. And what context-insensitive may alias analysis does is it maps, it provides a function that maps each expression in the program, like E1 and E2, to what is an abstract value. And I denote that function by sites. So sites of an expression gives an abstract value, which is a set of allocation sites. Now this might be the malloc function call in C, but in Java it is the call to new, when you create a new object. And what this function really means is that if E1 ever takes a value that has been allocated at some site, some new allocation site H, then it is guaranteed that H will be in the sites function applied to E1. Okay? Then the reason, then the way you can compute the complement of may alias E1 E2 is by just checking whether the intersection of the sites function applied to E1 and E2 is empty. Because the reason this holds is because if E1 and E2 never take values coming from the same site, then of course they can never have the same value in any execution. Okay. Now another idea in may alias analysis is what is called context sensitive analysis. And perhaps the most popular variant here is called KCFA. And I'll again illustrate this by means of another example. So let's see, there are 2 functions, foo and bar, both of which call a function baz. Now, you might want to analyze baz in multiple contexts, okay? Because maybe that foo and bar are doing very different things, so you don't want to merge the analysis results coming from foo and bar in baz. And for KCFA with k equal to 1, you analyze baz, in this program, you analyze it in 2 contexts. So once for foo and once for bar. So a context is essentially a call site. So if there are n call sites, this function baz will be analyzed n times. Okay. This can be generalized to arbitrary k values. So for k equal to n, what that means is you just use n levels of the call stack. So if k is 2, you would analyze baz once for every call site that calls foo and once for every call site that calls bar. Okay. And so on. Now, there are problems with both these ideas. With the first one is that there are too few abstract values in a program. And this is because there are only so many allocation sites in your program after all. What this means is that this condition will not be true as often as you want. So many times it will say that E1 and E2 may alias, when in fact they do not. Okay. And a problem with the second idea is that this is not just not the right notion of context. Because often what happens is sometimes you want to analyze Baz in just one context, even if it is called from two call sites. Because maybe after all, Foo and Bar don't have very different analysis results, and it's OK to merge them here. But then maybe sometimes you even want more than two Baz to be analyzed in more than two contexts. Because for instance here, maybe that E1 is carrying some context information along with it. So even for this one call, maybe you want to analyze Baz in multiple contexts. Okay, so this is just not the right notion of context, even though it has been quite popular in the May alias analysis literature. And both these problems are solved using a very recent form of May alias analysis, which is called K-object sensitive May alias analysis. Now, as I said, this is a recent May alias analysis that was proposed by Milanova et al. In ISTA 2003. And the way it solves the first problem is, instead of treating an abstract value as a set of allocation sites, it treats it as a set of strings of up to k allocation sites. So this is object sensitive. It just adds more context to abstract values. Okay, and now clearly, because you have more abstract values, this condition will be true more often than before. And that is why you'll have fewer false positives. And the way it solves the context problem is, instead of using call sites as context, it uses the allocation site of the this parameter. Now, this is useful for object-oriented languages, not just Java, but even C++ and C#, because the this parameter is treated in a special way. And so we want to track contexts not by call strings, but by what flows to these expressions E1 and E2. So for k equal to 1, Baz will be analyzed once for each distinct allocation site that is there in sites of E1 and in sites of E2. Okay, so you'll just ask, tell me all the allocation sites that at which a value might be created that flows to E1 or E2, and you'll analyze Baz for each such value. So maybe if there's just one allocation site which flows to both of them, you'll end up analyzing Baz just once, not twice, as in one CFA. And likewise, if there are lots of allocation sites which might evaluate to E1 and E2, you'll analyze Baz in that many contexts. Okay. So our contribution to K-object-sensitive analysis was that at the time we looked at it, there was no scalable implementation for even k equal to 1. Now, one thing to note is that this approach, this algorithm, is exponential in k. So it is not trivial to scale it to high values of k. And the insights we had is, the first is that we used symbolic representations for all relations. That includes all program relations that are inputs and all computed relations, such as the sites function I just showed. All of them are represented using so-called BDDs, which are binary decision diagrams. And this has been shown by others in recent work that was published in PLDI 2004, how to use BDDs to do May alias analysis. And another insight we had was that array state detection algorithm is demand-driven. What it means is that it begins with k equal to 1 for all allocation sites. But clearly, there are many allocation sites which are, for example, thread local. They are not visible to more than one thread. So we'll increment k only for those allocation sites that were involved in races. Okay, so we'll run this algorithm, which I showed earlier, multiple times. And each time, we'll increment k in a demand-driven fashion. Okay, so the end result is that we get scalability even up to k equal to 5 for the small number of allocation sites for which you need higher precision. Now, let's see where this K-object-sensitive May alias analysis fits in this algorithm over here. So clearly, it is needed in the computation of aliasing pairs. Because as I just mentioned, aliasing pairs asks whether a pair of expressions E1 and E2 may refer to the same location. So you directly use the result here. But it's perhaps not obvious. It's used in many other stages as well. For example, call graph construction in Java needs a precise May alias analysis, because otherwise you can't infer the target methods of dynamic dispatches precisely. So all these stages really require a precise May alias analysis. Okay, I won't talk about the analysis we use for shared and parallel pairs right now. They're interesting in their own right. But what I'll focus on is unlocked pairs. So suppose May alias analysis does not eliminate a pair of accesses. Suppose it is retained, it survives all these four stages. What do we do next? So let's return to our example program. So if we can, if we cannot prove that E1 and E2 never refer to the same value in any execution, we can try to prove the following, that L1 and L2, the locks, always refer to the same value in all executions. And this predicate is called must alias in the program analysis literature, and it is computed using a must alias analysis. Okay. Now, what has been done in must alias analysis? So there's been a small body of work. Unlike may alias analysis, this is a much harder problem. And in fact, this problem is so serious that many previous race detection approaches were stumbled by it, leading to fork wisdom, especially, for example, in the transaction memory forks, is that static race detection is just intractable. You cannot reason about programs that use fine-grained locking, that is, programs that create multiple locks and store them in data structures. Okay. And what we showed is that must alias analysis, in fact, is not necessary for the race detection problem. Yeah?
So in what sense is it much harder?
Well, so as I showed, there are two conditions here, right? One is may alias and the other is must alias. So people, we always view may alias, a may analysis, as much easier to compute than must analysis. Because in some sense, must requires you to tell whether this is holding in all executions, whether two things will have the same value in all executions. So the only way where a must alias analysis will work over here for race detection is in the case of global locks. Because it is easy to tell whether two global locks refer to the same global lock. But the moment you keep things in data structures and pass them around, must alias analysis is not able to disambiguate between different locks created at the same allocation site. Okay. So in that sense, must alias analysis has been viewed as, and somehow people associated locks with must alias analysis, that somehow you have to reason about a common lock held in terms of must alias analysis. Okay. And that is what led to this problem.
So you mean it's not computationally harder? You mean in practice it is hard to find must aliasing thing? I mean, relationship between?
I guess you mean to say that the information that a must alias analysis produces, it's much more narrower than a may alias, which is much more broad.
Yeah,
but that may make it actually easier, basically, to compute because it's a stronger property.
Yeah, but you end up with
most of the time, and then that's it.
Yeah. So now when
I want to understand what you mean by harder.
Yeah. Okay. So what I meant actually is what happens now is you end up saying that let's view at it this way. So suppose you have two variables x and y in your program. Okay, two expressions. Now, if x and y are coming from an allocation site that is executed at most once, then a must alias analysis can say that, okay, X and Y are must aliased. Okay, they always take the same value because that allocation site is what is called a single instance site. But the moment that site is in some loop, then what happens now is it cannot tell whether X and Y refer to the same value that was created at that site. And conservatively, it will say, no, they're not must aliased, which means that most of the time, you can't prove whether a common lock is held. So in some sense, must alias analysis is just not, if you view that must alias analysis is needed for locks and you stick to that view, then this problem just does not go away. And what most people have resorted to is they have used a must alias analysis, like I just mentioned, as a static pre-pass for their analysis. And then they have fallen back to dynamic race detection, which is why dynamic race detection was pretty much the industrial state of the art in this problem, precisely because of reasoning about fine-grained locks. So what we say is we propose a new idea which I call conditional must not alias analysis. And here's the insight behind this approach. It says that you need not try to prove L1 and L2 refer to the same value in all executions. What you can try to prove is that under the assumption that L1 and L2 refer to different values in an execution, if you can prove that E1 and E2 also refer to different values in that same execution, then I claim that field F is race-free. And I denote it by the following predicate. And the reason field F is race-free if this predicate holds is as follows. So let's assume that L1 and L2 refer to distinct values in an execution, right? What it means now is that two threads can simultaneously enter these sections because they are distinct locks. They can be held simultaneously by different threads. But now this predicate also says that if you have made this assumption that L1 and L2 are distinct, it means that E1 and E2 are also distinct values in that same execution. So even though these two threads can simultaneously execute these statements, they are not referring to the same location F because E1 and E2 are distinct values, and Java semantics ensures that the field F of distinct values is a distinct location. Okay. So I'll show how this idea can be.
You're assuming that each value has a unique and only one lock.
No. So okay, any value can be a lock in Java. So values are objects in Java, and any object.
This is very specific to Java.
It is specific to Java in the sense that we use k-object-sensitive may-alias analysis. That is something which is highly specific to object-oriented languages. I think it would also work for C-sharp or for C++, but not for C. In Java, another thing is that locks are ubiquitous because you can hold a lock on any object, whereas that's not the case in terms of, for example, in a language like C. So I don't think we are doing anything very specific to Java over here besides the k-object-sensitive may-alias analysis. Yeah.
So you have formulated your conditional must-not-alias analysis as an implication between two pairs. Isn't it in general that path condition?
Well, so actually this predicate is a lot more complicated than what I've written over here, because when I call terms like L1, L2, E1, and E2, there's actually implicitly a program point associated with it. So I'm referring to exactly this structure, and it is talking in terms of, as you said, there is a path condition involved here that after you, so there are four program points involved, and that these expressions are evaluated at those specific program points. Because maybe this code is executed multiple times in the same execution, right? So you can't pick the lock which was held at one point and then pick the expression E1 which was accessed at in maybe another iteration of this whole loop. So I'm just glossing over all that just to give you the main idea of conditional must not alias analysis. Yeah.
So typically use the word may alias, any over approximation is fine, and when you use the word must alias, any under approximation is fine. But here it seems like the two different occurrences of must not alias, one should be an over approximation and the other should be an under approximation for this to be solved. Which means you can make an error, because you will never be able to do a perfect analysis, you will always do an approximate analysis. But these two must not aliases should be different kinds of approximation.
Well, so essentially, I don't think we are computing these two separately. So here, one more thing I should mention is that the quantifier I'm talking about is the same in both these predicates. So that is why I keep stressing that these are both happening in the same execution. So under the assumption that L1 and L2 are distinct values in a particular execution, E1 and E2 are distinct values in that same execution. So it's not that we are computing these two predicates separately. So I'll just show how we are exactly computing this, and maybe then you can ask me again if it's not clear. So I'll show how this idea can be used for a more concrete program with multiple locking idioms, okay? So here's a single-threaded program, and essentially what I'll do is I'll use names H1, H2, H0 as labels of allocation sites, and I'll simulate the only execution of this program here. So what is happening here is first we execute the first statement and create an array of n values, which are labeled H0. Then we execute the first iteration of this loop. We create a value at site H1, and we link it as the zeroth element of the array we just created. We execute the next statement in the same iteration. We create a value at site H2 and assign it to the G field of the value we created. And then we repeat this process n-1 times, and this is the data structure we get. Okay. Now, this program is single-threaded, so let us add some concurrency to it. So let's suppose that there are a bunch of child threads which are spawned by this main thread. Okay, and I'll just show two of these threads, a blue one and a red one. What each of these threads is doing is it's non-deterministically picking an array element that is one of these H1 values. It is acquiring a lock on some expression which I'll not specify for now. And then it is proceeding to refer to the G field of the value it chose non-deterministically, reach the corresponding H2 field, and write something to the field F of this H2 value that it chose. Okay, now this program has a race between these pairs of accesses, provided if synchronization is not used correctly. In particular, both child threads might simultaneously access the same array element and proceed to write to the same field F of the same H2 value. Okay, so there's a race over here. Now let's instantiate the locks with the easiest case, which is coarse-grained locking. Let's assume that the lock is the array expression A. Okay, now intuitively this is an easy case because this is the case of global locks. There are few locks to reason about. And I'll show how conditional must-not aliasing can be used to prove this program race-free. So here's the predicate I wrote earlier, and I'll instantiate L1 and L2 with A, which are the locks, and E1 and E2 with X1.g and X2.g respectively. So here's the predicate we have. Now what we want to prove is, under the assumption that A and A refer to distinct values in an execution, do X1.g and X2.g refer to distinct values in that same execution? And it turns out that this predicate is the antecedent is false, because A and A can never refer to distinct values in any execution, because there's just a single value that ever flows to A. And because the antecedent is false, this entire expression is trivially true. And so using conditional must not aliasing, we have proven that this program is race-free. This is exactly what I meant that reasoning about global locks is easy. Okay. Now let us look at the other extreme, which I'll call fine-grained locking. Okay. So what each thread is doing here is it's non-deterministically choosing an array element. Then it's holding a lock. It's following the G field and holding a lock on the corresponding H2 value. And then it's writing something to its F field. Now, the reason this case is also easy is because even though now you have lots of locks, because there are n locks over here, you are writing to some location which is very close to that lock. So the lock is guarding a data structure which is very close in the heap to that lock. Okay. So this case is also easy, as I'll show using conditional must not aliasing once again. So this time I'll instantiate L1 and L2 with x1.g and x2.g. And what this predicate says is, can you prove, under the assumption that x1.g and x2.g refer to distinct values in an execution, can you prove that x1.g and x2.g also refer to distinct values in that same execution? And clearly, this predicate is trivially true, because the antecedent is the same as the consequent. Yeah?
So I have a question. This may be a trivial question, but supposing if it was sync y1 and sync y2.
Yeah.
And if must not alias of y1 and y2 is true.
Yeah.
Then does that imply that must not alias of x1.g and x2?
So it depends on where these y1s and y2s come from. So it's not just a syntactic analysis we are doing. So we do analyze bytecode, which means that big complex expressions will be split into temporaries. So if y1 and y2 are coming from x1.g and x2.g.
But supposing they're not coming from x1.g.
Oh, well, so in that case, then what will happen is that then you also need to ask whether maybe that x1.g and x2.g never refer to the same value. So our May alias analysis, which I talked about earlier,
so it's will not just must not alias implies must not alias.
So this is the second part of the problem I'm solving. So I've said that first, there is the first part, which is a May alias analysis. We do that still. And we compute aliasing pairs, parallel pairs, and shared pairs. Then we do conditional must not aliasing to compute unlocked pairs, because those are the ones where you have to reason about locks now if you want to eliminate any more. And what I'm saying is, instead of using a must alias analysis that people have done in the past, at least in the alias analyzing based analyzing techniques, I'm saying let's show how this can be done using conditional must not alias analysis. So one thing you can try to prove is these statements are not at all conflicting. That is, they never refer to the same value. Or what you can try to prove is that under the assumption that the locks are distinct, can you prove that the values are also distinct? Okay. Okay, so this case is also trivial to reason about. But now let's return to the hardest case, which is medium-grained locking. What is going on over here is each thread non-deterministically chooses an array element but holds a lock on that element itself, then proceeds to refer to its G field, and then gets the corresponding H2 value and writes to its F field. Now, the reason this is a hard case is because there are multiple locks here, unlike the coarse-grained locking case, which are stored in data structures. And furthermore, the locks are far away from the data structures they guard. So for example, you're holding locks here to guard values which are updated here. Okay, and this is also a very common case, because you want to strike a balance between the amount of parallelism you have in your program and the overhead of locking. So you neither want very little parallelism by holding global locks, nor do you want lots of locks where there's lots of overhead of locking and unlocking. So this is also a common case, and we want a precise static analysis to handle this case. And once again, I can show that conditional must not aliasing can address this problem. So I instantiate this predicate this time with x1, x2, x1.g, and x2.g. And I want to prove that under the assumption that x1 and x2 refer to distinct values, can x1.g and x2.g also refer to distinct values in the same execution? And the reason this predicate is true once again is more subtle than in the earlier cases. So here, let's assume that x1 and x2 refer to distinct values in some execution, right? So that means they have to be distinct array elements over here. Now, the reason x1.g and x2.g are distinct values in that execution is because if you follow the G fields of those distinct values, the way this data structure is constructed, it's clear that there's no way you can reach the same values by following the G fields of distinct H1 values. Okay, you always reach distinct H2 values. And that is why this predicate is true. Now, what this motivates is what we call a disjoint reachability analysis. That is, we want to infer when can a field G of distinct H1 values, for example, can be linked to distinct H2 values. Okay, so I'll talk a bit about disjoint reachability, and I'll then show how that can be used to compute conditional must not aliasing. Okay, so let's once again look at this data structure that was constructed. Now, disjoint reachability, the property, states that if in every execution of this program, from distinct H1 values, if we can reach via one or more fields only distinct H2 values, that is, you can never reach the same H2 value. And notice that there's already some abstraction going on in this property. So you don't name, you don't care what the labels are on those fields. So we throw out all the labels. And if these conditions hold, then we say that the set H2 is contained in the DR function applied to the set H1. So DR stands for disjoint reachability. And the reason I'm talking about sets of allocation sites is because recall that our abstract values are sets of allocation sites. We're using a May alias analysis here. And the easiest case is when these sets are singletons, but I won't talk about the case. In general, they can be sets of size more than one. But let's just focus on the singleton case over here. So whenever this fact holds, what it means is that from distinct H1 values, there's no way you can reach the same H2 value by following one or more fields in the heap. Okay. Now clearly this property cannot be computed because it's quantifying over all executions, even though in this simple case there's just one execution. So realistic programs will have infinitely many executions, and we want to statically, conservatively approximate our DR. And this is the topic of our Popple 2007 paper, but I'll briefly tell the way we compute DR. So essentially what we want to reason about is the time at which values are created and the time at which they are linked together. Okay. And in order to reason in a finite way about time, we use concepts from early work in parallelizing compilers, namely iteration space and dependence distance. So what we realize is that, what we note is that whenever an H1 value is created in a particular iteration of the loop, the only loop in this program which I showed, it turns out that you immediately also create the corresponding H2 value and link it in that same loop iteration. Okay, so even though that loop is executed potentially, an unbounded number of times, it's always the case that from distinct H1 values, you're always linking them via the G field to distinct H2 values. So we reason about loops, and that is how we can compute such facts. Now, in an implementation, this would we also have recursive methods. So it's not just loops that we deal with. In fact, we translate all loops to tail recursive methods. And now whatever I said about loops just applies to methods. Okay.
So you still have
what?
Shape.
Okay, so this is a lightweight form of shape analysis, but it's very lightweight. So if you see, all that we are doing is, and the key reason is here, okay, so we don't specify any path properties. So this is a flow insensitive property. It is saying in all executions, just see what are the heap updates that are done. Don't construct a precise graph of the heap at each point. And if there's ever an update done, just add an edge to that graph. And then you ask whether in that graph, can I ever reach from distinct H1 values to the same H2 value? So it's a flow insensitive property. It's a very lightweight form of shape analysis. For example, we can prove facts such as from if the heads of two linked lists are distinct, are their bodies also distinct? So that's a shape analysis property some people might be interested in, but not more complicated properties.
So, yeah. Later on, relink the fields.
Oh, you are allowed to. So that's fine. So any kind of update will be viewed as, will be taken into account. So maybe you mutate certain fields. And so this analysis will have false positives at certain times. It does rely that people, in particular, the main thing it relies on is whenever you create an object in a particular loop iteration, you a lock, you immediately create the data structure which is being guarded by the lock in that same loop iteration, or at least in some iteration related to that one. Like maybe the lock came from the previous iteration. The classic case where this fails is if you have two separate loops, you haven't jammed them, you create the locks in the first loop, maybe store them in an array. Now in the second loop, you create the data structures again in that same array, and you link the two. You link each lock with its corresponding data structure. So you are using the fact that the integers in the loop iterations are correlated, but we don't analyze integers. So that would be a false positive in our case. Yeah.
So must not is the dual of May alias, right? So what motivated you to design a new must not alias analysis as opposed to designing a more fancy May alias analysis?
Well, so May alias analysis, right, can the main problem here is May alias analysis cannot reason about distinct values created at the same allocation site.
Well, depends upon which May alias analysis you are
Yeah, so at some point, like key object sensitivity, right? It essentially, what it says is I'm adding more context to that allocation set, so it's much better than context insensitive May alias analysis. But there's only a certain point at which you can keep adding contexts. So at some point, so at this level, I think it was just much easier to just design take a fundamentally different approach of viewing how to correlate locks with data structures. So it's not must not aliasing that we are computing; it's this implication which we are computing.
So now what I feel is that, you know, you can potentially also apply your ideas to compute a fancy May aliasing analysis.
Yeah. Okay. So now this. So essentially, one thing I haven't told is what are abstract values, right? So we start off with sets of allocation sites, but actually it's not quite that because it's k object sensitive. So it's allocation sites with this context attached, which is up to strings of up to k allocation sites. Okay. But it goes even more than that. So there's a loop vector now which is attached with each allocation site, which says in which iteration of each loop in the program was this abstract value created. So in that sense, you are right. We are getting a more and more precise May alias analysis. There are implementation challenges here because a program might have thousands or even more than that loops. But most of them, values will not be created in most of the loops. So you can just compress the information you have for most loops in the program and just keep it for maybe those few two or three nested loops in which that value was created. So yeah, it could be used as a more powerful May alias analysis. Okay.
So let's say after allocating H1 and linking H2 to a particular field, somewhere else in the program there was an update from H1 to some other, like A of 0.H1 to A of 2.H1.
Yeah.
So how will this graph change?
Okay, so the way this graph will change is it will now have multiple edges from. So this graph is just to show the dynamic property. Okay, it is not. So this is just to give a feel for what the disjoint reachability property is. So the way this graph would change in the property, not in the analysis, is we would keep adding an edge whenever there's an update, but we won't remove existing edges. So if you had linked something, and now you updated that field to something else, we'll keep the previous edge. Okay. So this graph might have multiple edges here. And in that graph, we'll ask this question again.
So I think it goes back to the question I asked before, which was that if you later on relink an H2 to be also a child of another H1, so now H2 is a child of two H1s. So you're breaking the invariant that you're using in the analysis.
Exactly.
You said that your flow analysis
The property itself is flow insensitive. So you are right. So if we later on, so if you are saying that what if this edge was, say, broken and linked here, right? Now, in fact, in that case, we are doing the right thing. It's not a false positive because maybe that if there's an edge here, and the old one was destroyed, then what two child threads could do is non-deterministically choose, hold locks on these two values, which are distinct, so simultaneously both threads get access, and both could write to the follow the G field to the same value and write something to its F field.
So at that point, it's not a tree any longer, and your analysis discovers that you don't have the tree.
So yeah, this fact wouldn't hold in the case, and we wouldn't even have false positives. The way we would have false positives is suppose someone mutated this field to point here, but later again set it back to this. Okay, and then did this access. Now then our analysis is confused because it's flow insensitive. It says it was at some point assigned to the same thing. So in that sense, we are relying on Java's property that the constructors in Java, essentially, these new allocation sites, the moment they create an object, you're obligated to even initialize the fields of that object. So typically, when you hold a lock on an object, you'll guard only those data structures which you initialized in that same iteration in which you called that constructor of the top level class, which is why this technique works most of the time. Okay. So let's assume that we have a function dr that is conservatively computed using the static analysis I mentioned. Let's see how one could do conditional must not alias analysis using dr. Okay. So let's once again look at the program we have been looking at, and here's the predicate which I mentioned, the conditional must not alias analysis predicate. I claim that this predicate is implied by the following two conditions. Okay, so we are conservatively approximating it. And what the first condition says is it's referring to the sites function from a May alias analysis, and it's taking the sites of four expressions, E1, E2, L1, and L2. So I'll denote them using these four blobs. Recall that they are sets of allocation sites. Now we are taking the union of the allocation sites of L1 and L2, and we are taking the intersection of the allocation sites of E1 and E2. And then we are asking whether this intersection set is contained in the dr function applied to this, the union of these two sets. Okay. Furthermore, we require that E1 be must reachable along all paths from L1, and likewise E2 be reachable along all paths from L2. So clearly there are some program points we are talking about here that's implicit in this definition. And I claim that if these two conditions hold, then the conditional must not aliasing predicate holds. And the reason is, for that predicate to hold, let's assume that L1 and L2 refer to distinct values in an execution, right? Now I want to prove that E1 and E2 also refer to distinct values in that same execution. But for the sake of contradiction, let's assume that E1 and E2 refer to the same value. Okay. Now, because L1 and L2 refer to distinct values, they might be allocated at any site in the union, which is why we take the union. And because I'm assuming that E1 and E2 have the same value, it is guaranteed that they must be coming from some site in the intersection. Okay. Now, these two conditions are assumed to be true. So what it means is that the DR function applied here, what this means is, from distinct L1 and L2 values, there's no way you can reach the same value over here. Okay, that was the definition of DR. But this condition is saying, on the other hand, that E1 is reachable from L1 along all paths, and E2 is reachable from L2 along all paths. So that means that the same value is reachable from distinct values that L1 and L2 take, which is a contradiction. Okay, so that is why if these two conditions hold, then conditional must not aliasing holds. And this is exactly the property that we end up checking. So we use the sites function from a May alias analysis. We compute DR, as I've shown earlier, by analyzing all loops and recursive methods. And then this is a simple reachability check along all paths. Okay. So let's see how this helps in the hardest case, which we have been looking at so far. Here are the two conditions I've still kept, and I'll instantiate E1, E2, L1, and L2 appropriately. And now it's easy to see what sites are for these four expressions. So for X1 and X2, they always are assigned array element values. That means the sites always come from H1. So it's a singleton set H1. And likewise, sites of X1.g and X2.g. If you see the whole program and see what are the sites at which values are created, then it is just H2. So this set is also singleton. And therefore, this is the condition which we get in this case. And as I mentioned earlier, this predicate is true. And likewise, furthermore, x1.g is reachable from x1. This is syntactic over here. You don't even have to do any other analysis. And likewise, x2.g is reachable from x2, because it's a prefix of these expressions. So both these conditions are true, and thus we have shown how conditional must not aliasing can be used to prove race freedom here. Okay. Now, we have implemented this technique in a tool we call CORD, and we experimented in particular with 2L multithreaded Java programs. This includes both smaller programs that have been used in previous work, as well as larger, mature, and widely used open source programs. And this benchmark suite includes both whole programs as well as libraries, which are open programs. And the output and discussions with developers is available at this web page. And these programs are currently being used by other researchers as well for evaluating race detection algorithms. Now, here are the 12 benchmarks. The line drawn here says that these are the smaller benchmarks, whereas the ones here are larger. These are the benchmarks that have been looked at by people in previous years. But here, these are the remaining benchmarks are all new, okay. And here's the number of classes in each of these benchmarks. Here's the total number of lines of code, thousands of lines of code. A brief description, and here's the running time of CORD on each of these benchmarks. So our largest one was Apache Derby, which is a relational database engine, and it has about 646,000 lines of code, and CORD ran in about 36 minutes on this benchmark. Okay. So here's the number of pairs of accesses retained for each of these benchmarks after each of the stages I've talked about. And this is a log scale. Okay. So we begin with the set of all pairs of accesses. As I mentioned earlier, Derby, which is about 646,000 lines of code, has almost 70 million pairs of accesses to begin with. So this is 10 million. And in the first stage itself, using a May alias analysis, we cut it down to 1 million. And then it goes on dropping further. Unlocked pairs is what we report for manual inspection, and racing pairs is what we determine as real races. Yeah.
So is there a reason
Now you apply them in that order?
Exactly. So I was coming to that. So there is no good reason why. It's just more intuitive to use this ordering for us. But we could easily change the ordering. In fact, here, it's not clear now which stage is doing better than all. But in the end, it doesn't matter from a practical viewpoint because you are taking the intersection of what is retained by all these stages. So maybe that even here, though here, you see that there's not much change happening. So it doesn't mean that the parallel pairs stage is bad. It might be that if this parallel stage had been run first, it would have eliminated a lot more excesses. And if you look at different benchmarks, then different techniques have different stages benefit different benchmarks differently. Like here, you see there is a drop right from what is remaining of the shared pairs. And one thing to note here is the gap between the unlocked pairs and the racing pairs is really small. That's the false positive rate. And I'll actually classify what is happening in this unlocked pairs. This is what we did by manual inspection. So we inspected each pair of accesses retained in unlocked pairs, and we classified them into either false positives. These are essentially due to imprecision in our approach, in some stage in our approach. Or they are a real race. Now, real races are further classified into so-called harmful and benign races. Okay, so a false positive rate just considers these as false, not benign races as false. Okay, so a race is benign if it is intentional, in the sense that the programmer knows about the race but is not ready to fix it for performance reasons. And this classification is quite subjective, so it is not clear it's not formally defined what a benign race is. So this is anyway entirely based on manual inspection, in which case we talked to developers and felt that this case is benign. And this reasoning requires a lot of work because the Java memory model has very subtle cases where most benign races turn out to be, that people think are benign, are actually real races. Okay, so in that is why we have very few benign races. We could convince developers most of the time that given the definition of the Java memory model, that certain things which they thought were benign earlier are no longer the case. Okay. And finally, here's the number of bugs which come from these harmful races. So now suppose we have 1,018 races. Now many of these races will point to the same missing lock, for instance. Okay, so they boil down to 319 distinct bugs, which are roughly the number of distinct source code changes that were needed to fix all these races. Okay, and here's the... Yeah, so this is essentially IBM's CloudScape relational database engine, which it made open source at some point. And that was picked up by the Apache Software Foundation. And they call it Derby. So I think it's one of, in the databases community, it is an open source, a good test bed for. It is quite mature. So the reason there are so many bugs over here is because developers come in and go out. And when such a thing happens, this is a classic case where if your program increases in size, the number of bugs do not increase linearly. So the moment the program gets twice as large doesn't mean it will just have twice as many bugs. So the problem here is on scale. More and more developers are coming in, and each one doesn't know what locks the other one, the previous one, has held, which I'll just show you on this developer feedback slide. So over here, so we found 16 bugs in JTDS. So this is an open source JDBC driver. It's the fastest for Microsoft SQL Server as well as for Sybase. So these are production quality programs. And when I began working on this benchmark, the lead developer told us that there were no concurrency issues here as far as they were aware of. And after they had fixed these 16 bugs, this is what we got back. So people do feel that they don't have concurrency bugs, but they are there. Then we found 17 bugs in Apache Commons Pool. This is a thread. This is an object pooling library that is used by many open source Java projects, whether they want to pool database connections or network sockets or thread pools. And there was a new release after the fixing these bugs for this particular library. So this is a case where there's an open program that you want to analyze before other clients use it. And finally, for Derby, we found 319 bugs. And here's what we got from one engineer at Sun who was working. So there are many people from other companies who are actually working on this project. They are not just freelance programmers. So it is a serious piece of code that, as you see in his comment, the reason they want to run this tool regularly is because as new people come in, even if you have fixed a race today, there's a good chance that someone will come in and fix it tomorrow. Yeah.
So for these projects, they've never run like runtime analysis tool for data race detection?
No, I think there's no available, there's no publicly available dynamic race detector. I think all the ones that I'm aware of, Okay, yeah. So one is for Java especially, but even for other languages, I think the moment one of these comes up, a company takes it over. Like Eraser is not publicly available. It is owned by HP. Then Intel has its own dynamic race detector. IBM has its own. I think Sun has its own. But none of them makes it available to others. So I don't think these people have even dynamic race detectors to find these bugs. Yeah.
There's a beta plugin for Valgrind, but it's not really ready for prime time yet.
Yeah. So, that is another one that I forgot to mention. So I think this will become more common. So people will use dynamic analysis. One thing to note, though, is dynamic analysis wouldn't work for an open program to begin with. So you would have to wait till clients use it and then find bugs and report back. Okay.
You say it's in the Derby example, it's new developers coming in and out. So do they raise as manifest themselves in certain areas if they code base?
So it is published on my webpage, but I don't quite remember now which were the packages where there were the most bugs or something like that. So I don't know if there were any specific locations. I did not analyze that in great detail. I think what is mainly needed is a good annotation language, which is slowly coming up in Java. There's a JSR which introduces at least some idioms which Cormac Flanagan and Stephen Freund and others have proposed. Like associating a type system for associating locks with data structures they guard. But I don't know. So some annotations there can be quite verbose, especially if some field of a class is being guarded by a lock which is coming from outside, then you have to use the same kinds of annotations as you have for Java 6, for Java 5.
So these examples never always use the Java lock discipline. So don't use interlocked operations, scattered around.
Well, another kind of implicit synchronization that is there is the fork-based synchronization, right? So if a parent thread spawns a child thread, then there's no race possible between some access it did before and something that's happening in the child thread. So that is handled by a parallel pair stage. That is exactly what it's doing. It's trying to find what things can happen in parallel. But other disciplines like barrier synchronization, so we did not look at the Java Grande benchmark suite because of this reason, because most of them are like these scientific array manipulating programs where analysis, and they use barrier-based synchronization. They use the sync construct, but they are locks are very different from ours. So there clearly we would have lots of false positives. So we never looked at this. So this is just targeting the idiom that is used by most programs. I'm not sure this would work for this concurrency, the new concurrency utilities, because they are flow sensitive, acquiring and releasing lock operations. Whereas I'm just handling lexically scoped locks right now. So, but that I don't think is a major problem. People have solved this problem of matching release locks with acquire locks. For example, file open with file close. So there are standard techniques for doing those kinds of things. Yeah, so it would have to be more flow sensitive than the kinds of analysis we are doing. But it's just extra work that I thought I won't do for now. So there were projects where people did use flow sensitive locking where we could have gotten lots of false positives. The case is even worse for C, where people use not just flow sensitive locking, but path sensitive locking. So there's a predicate which guards whether you acquire a lock, and then you use the same predicate to check whether to release the lock. So we are nowhere path sensitive. So we get flow sensitive in certain stages, but never path sensitive. But that also means we can scale to larger programs. Yeah.
So how common is people using this syntactic synchronization?
It is very common in at least before the Java 5 concurrency library was introduced. I haven't looked at programs which use that library for locking. So that is something I would like to look at in the future. But at least before that, everybody used syntactic. The only way one could do that is design their own semaphores which acquire locks and release locks. So I don't think anybody wants to go through that pain of designing their own lock preppers.
And so what's the cost of applying your tool to a new code base? You don't need any kind of
annotation. Oh, yeah. So there are no annotations at all in this approach. Our PLDI work did have the need for annotations, but this is completely automatic. So this is fully push button. For open programs, you do have to specify, like if you want to check java.util.hashtable, you have to specify the entry points. That is what two threads might execute. And our analysis is not fully sound for open programs yet. There are many issues about concurrency, what does it even mean that an open program is race free, right? I mean, someone could extend that class and do nasty things. So there are some things that we guarantee, but largely for open programs, it boils down to a bug finding technique then, because we automatically generate a harness. All the approaches here, we have a whole program essentially, like malicious analysis is a whole program analysis, so in the sense that model checking. So we don't do a type based like analysis that, for example, Flanagan, Fruend and others do. But then we don't even do a path sensitive analysis like many model checkers would do. So just a crude harness, which just in a flow insensitive way just calls the entry points, suffices to find bugs for us. Okay. So that is the only annotation one would need. If you were to just give java.util.hashtable and say this is the class where anything can be called in parallel, then you don't have to specify anything. But if there are some methods where there's some maybe regular expression like automate on how methods could be called, that would be more complex and would require some feedback. Otherwise, you would get lots of false positives. So I'll briefly touch upon related work. There's a lot of work on static race detection I talked about briefly. There are type systems, data flow analyses, and model checkers with increasing complexity. But the two main problems here is, one is you have to approximate multiple aspects, which I mentioned. And the second is many techniques perceive this as a must alias analysis problem, especially the data flow analysis techniques. And even if you look at Flanagan and Fruend's technique, they assume that fields are actually final when you hold locks on certain things. So this must alias analysis does actually pop up in every race detector that I'm aware of, in some sense or the other. And they don't check whether a field is really final, so there's some unsoundness there as well. And what is the end result of having these two problems is that past techniques have either sacrificed precision, soundness, scalability, or some combination of these. Okay. Perhaps dynamic race detection, as some people here mentioned, is currently the state of the art in the industry. But there are two problems with this. One is they'll be inherently unsound. So it's only as good as your test suite. And the second thing is it cannot analyze libraries like the Apache Commons pool, which I mentioned. By dynamic analysis, I mean purely dynamic analysis. Okay, so this is stuff that actually runs the code. And right now, there's a full spectrum which blurs the distinction between what is dynamic and what is static by maybe using symbolic values. But what I mean by this is purely dynamic approaches, which need a whole program to run. And finally, as someone mentioned, this is slightly related to work on shape analysis. This is another large body of work in program analysis, and it's much more expensive than the disjoint reachability properties that we can compute. Okay, so we can say, for example, prove things like if heads of linked lists are distinct, then the bodies are distinct, but nothing more fancy than that. And finally, here's a summary of the contributions of this approach. And first is it is precise, and it's also sound. And the key idea to precision is using a particular form of May alias analysis called K-object sensitive analysis. And the key idea behind soundness is what I've described as conditional must not alias analysis. Now, both of these have applications in other areas as well. For example, race detection is now being viewed as an important client for evaluating future May alias analyses. So the earlier clients have been just simple analyses like call graph construction and mod ref analyses. But this is really a stress test for May alias analysis. You can really evaluate it much better. You can evaluate a new May alias analysis in a much better way if you use race detection as a client. Likewise, conditional must not alias analysis is not even a concurrency property. It is a property that can be defined for sequential programs. So it has applications besides race detection. One example is object field inlining. And there are many other applications which I can talk about that do have the conditional must not alias analysis flavor. And together, these two properties yield an effective race detector, which has found hundreds of bugs in mature Java programs. And many of these have been fixed by developers. Okay, and I'll talk briefly about what work I would like to do in the future. So the first is analyzing higher level concurrency properties. So it is well known that even though races are fundamental in concurrency, they are still low level. So this is the classic motivation for atomicity, that races are neither sound nor complete. And that is one of the things that I would like to work on. But one thing I would like to mention here is races do pop up in all kinds of problems. So all the infrastructure I have could be used for other problems as well. Secondly, I would like to explore language idioms for concurrent programming from both perspectives. That is, what idioms can facilitate program analysis tools, and what idioms can facilitate program understanding by programmers. And what I mean by the first bullet is that arrays detector has certain favors certain programs in the sense that what I feel is that when we have low false positives for a certain program, there are certain idioms which that program is using that if we could crystallize formally, then what we could say is if your program uses this subset of Java, then in return what we have is a good static race detector for you. And essentially this would solve all kinds of problems that are there today. Like for example, there's a large body of work on memory models. And there wouldn't be the need for complicated memory models if someone had a good static race detector, because you need memory models because you don't have a good race detector in the first place. So if you knew exactly which things could happen in parallel, you could just focus on those instead of defining a memory model now which says it's up to you if you do certain things in parallel. The consequences are defined as follows. So from the second perspective, what I feel is today there are no good idioms for expressing concurrency idioms. Like one, the classic one I mentioned was which locks guard which data structures. But the problem is more severe than that. For example, the most glaring case in Java is the servlets library. So even in its documentation, this library does not mention what are the concurrency constructs in it. Okay, like what things can happen in parallel, on what objects do you need to hold locks. And the end result is that now every implementation of servlets uses its own concurrency idioms. So for example, Tomcat and JBoss, they are both highly concurrent implementations of servlets, but both they're not restrained to hold locks on certain objects when doing certain operations in that library. Okay, so what this means is that if you're writing a web application that uses servlets, then the best way to actually ensure that it is correct is, one is you either look at the implementation in your web browser, the servlet implementation, like it's Tomcat or whatever, or what people do today is just use common sense and try to and just hope that the underlying implementation would have made the same decisions as you are making. And that is precisely what is stated in the recent book on Java concurrency, that this is the most flagrant violation in terms of that even in its documentation, it does not say what is happening in these libraries. Others are improving, like Hashtable, for example, does say that it is thread safe, at least in its documentation, but it's not quite up to the mark for many other libraries. Finally, I'll conclude with a summary of my broader research. So this talk was primarily about static analysis, in particular alias analysis for verifying concurrent properties of programs. But I've also worked on dynamic analysis, and that is for debugging as opposed to verifying. And it's about arbitrary memory safety properties of C programs. This was done in the context of the cooperative bug isolation project. I've also worked on model checking, another static analysis approach, for verifying temporal safety properties of C programs. And this was done in the context of the SLAM model checker here. And finally, there are lots of competing sub-communities in the static analysis community. And once in a while, I like to explore what is the relationship between these different approaches and what are the benefits and drawbacks of these approaches, and whether something can be learned in one approach from another approach. And that's it. So are there any questions? Yeah.
So there's this work on synchronization removal. For example, the paper by Eric Rowe.
Yeah.
So the objective over there is to figure out pairs which are not racing so that you can eliminate all the synchronization.
Yeah.
So it seems to me that the information that is required in that analysis is a complement of the information that you're actually using.
Yeah. So in some sense, our first stage, right, which is all this aliasing pairs, parallel pairs, and shared pairs, are doing exactly this. It's trying to find what are the pairs of accesses that are not even related, they are not even conflicting. And much of this work, as you mentioned, is one of the problems we heard from developers is when they want to fix races, now they are introducing performance overhead. And that is a potential problem that people might want to work on. So in the beginning, you begin with concurrency because you want performance, right? And now for fixing these races, you are again introducing locks and lowering performance. So, but I haven't worked on this kind of stuff. There was a lot of work on this synchronization removal, I guess in 99 or something like that in Uppsala. But I think after that, there has been a lot of work in making acquiring and releasing lock operations really efficient, and even reentrant locks and all that stuff. So maybe that problem will come back again. So performance is going to come back again. But I just felt that it wasn't a problem to focus on for me. But you're right, that underlying techniques are similar. Yeah.
In
might change the code base by a little bit. Like, you know, you had the comment about a check-in.
Yeah.
How much does the analysis change?
Yeah, it is not incremental. So, I mean, this... yeah, so I don't have much knowledge about incremental May alias analysis. That is the main thing over here. May alias analysis is the one which is whole program. And there are modular May alias analysis, but I mean, I don't know of any that scales well. So in that sense, you just have to run the... So this would be more like a nightly build. It's not something that you edit some code and you immediately run it and see whether something has been broken. So you would run this once in a... It takes tens of minutes. So you would have to run it maybe once a day. Okay, thank you.